Well, I have a research group in the Department of Management Science and Engineering that does risk analysis. I've done a lot of work on offshore oil platforms, on space systems, including the space shuttle, more recently on satellites, and we are now interested in cybersecurity. The question being, what do we have that we want to protect? What are the vulnerabilities in the system where these jewels are located, and how can we plug the gaps? I do cybersecurity with three of my PhD students, Marshall Kuipers, Matthew Smith, Captain US Army, and Philip Keller. Matt Smith got interested in a smart grid. There is a point, though, where creating vulnerabilities by putting more interconnections creates a risk and a cost that may exceed the benefits of the smartness. So that's why I say up to a point it's wonderful, and after that, the smarter, the dumber, because you have introduced more points and more interconnections that introduce vulnerabilities. And then Philip Keller got interested in a very important problem, which is how often should you change, modify, upgrade your software, given that some people might be trying to enter your system to do some damage to it. Marshall Kuipers has been working with me on a large data set that we got from the federal government. And what he has done is to look at the stability of the system of attacks. So what he has found out through that data set is that, contrary to what we thought, the number of attacks have not increased. So it's staying ahead of the bad guys, if you wish, in terms of cybersecurity and the kind of software that we have. What you find out when you look at this data set is that the cyber risk is dominated by a lot of constant small incidents that occur all the time, what we call the ankle biters. And those are the ones that are not going to cause a lot of damage, but are going to, most of the time, but are going to be a pain because it's repeated incidents that have to be taken care of. Then you have people in groups that are the criminals, and the criminals who try to get your data sets because what they want to do is to use the credit cards that you have, for which you have the numbers and the owners and all the information that's needed to get money out of that. Another is another type of attackers, and it generally comes from a nation state, repeated, persistent kind of attacks. Generally trying to get at your intellectual property, whether it's your technology, whether it's intelligence information that can be used. They may not be successful the first time, but sooner or later they may be able to intrude. So that's when you need to be really aware of potential vulnerabilities. Those that can come from the code, that might be inadvertent, there's a mistake, a bug in the code, so you want to make sure that you know where the vulnerabilities are. Second, once the attacker is inside, the attacker may want to navigate through that maze to find what they are looking for. So you have to make it as complicated as you can. Third, the extraction. So you have to be able to see that some information has been extracted from your system. And then finally, if they have been successful in extracting the information, you want to make sure that you detect the effect as fast as possible. And so what we do is to look for very specific means of protection at their costs in terms both of hours of investigation, but also the costs in market terms, the costs to your reputation, the costs of losing your technology, and the benefits of what you are trying to implement, for example, trying to put several levels of protection to the entry of the system. What we do typically is to analyze the system itself, decompose the system into its subsystems, and look at the failure modes. So what are the ways the autonomous vehicles can mess up? Well, they can hit the car in front, they can go off the road, they can stop working altogether in the middle of a freeway. So then we go back to the systems that can cause these incidents, and we look at all the information that we have about them, the design of them, the engineering analysis models, expert opinions, test results that are extremely important of each of the subsystems. That's the way we would address this, in the same way we would for a new type of satellite. But if they have a new optic system and that the collection of data depends critically on that optic system, we're going to take it apart to see how it can fail before we put it in orbit. So that's how we address things that we have not seen yet. There was a company and that had an interruption of service, and which was quite severe. And the question was, well, when is the last time you have changed your software, modified your software? Well, it had never been modified for 10 years. And in fact, the man who had created it had died 6 years ago, so they had no idea what the software was. And of course, that gave all the time to the people who wanted to attack that system to do so, to find their way through it. It costs a lot of money to change your software regularly, if nothing else, the interruption of service that it takes to do that. So clearly, you cannot do that every day. And so there is a trade-off between the frequency with which you're going to do that and the benefits of risk reduction that these changes are going to bring. You look at things in probabilistic terms, and that's the only way that I know how to do that kind of exercise. So that's why we do a probabilistic risk analysis. We present our results under the form of probability distributions, and depending on the risk attitude of the decision makers, they can decide where they want to put most of their efforts.
Thank you.